Well, hey, welcome back to church tonight. If you haven't found your seat already, go ahead and grab it and then stand. Let's start our service tonight. Come now, fount of every blessing. Tune my heart. Come thou fount of every blessing, tune my heart to sing thy grace, streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise, teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above, praise his name, I'm fixed upon. Name of God's redeeming love. This next verse starts with, here I raise my Ebenezer. Don't think Scrooge. Wrong season. In 1 Samuel chapter 7, after God gave the Israelites this great victory, Samuel took this big rock and put it up as a memorial, and he called it Ebenezer, or Stone of Help. So every time they looked at it, they would remember that God was their help. Shameless plug, Pastor Skelly starts a new podcast on 1 Samuel tomorrow. As we all know, it'll be a while before he gets to chapter 7. But let's sing that stanza, here I raise a stone of help, my Ebenezer. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I'm come, and I hope by thy good pleasure, safely Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger, bought me with his precious blood. And we sang about that blood this morning. Oh, how grace. Oh, to grace, how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to. Let thy goodness, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above. Well, like I said last week, Sunday nights to learn some new songs, to refresh some old songs. Because of this whole COVID thing, we've kind of lost some of our repertoire from not singing as often. First one I want to sing for you is called His Mercy Is More. We did this a few times a few years back. I want to sing the chorus for you, just to remind you, and then we'll sing it together. It goes like this. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more, stronger than darkness new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. A couple things I want to show you, because it depends on who you listen to sing it. They sing it a little bit different, so we're going to sing it all the same way. The praise the Lord goes up. Praise the Lord. It comes down just a little bit. His mercy more goes up. And keeps coming down. More, stronger than darkness new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Got it? Let's sing it together. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more, stronger than darkness new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. What love? What love could remember no wrongs we have done? Omniscient, all knowing, He counts not their sum, thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Darkness to every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is. is born. What patience. What patience would wait as we constantly roam. What Father so tender is calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many. His mercy is more. Praise the Lord. Of kindness he lavished on us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood in a debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more.
Thank you for that, James. And Lindsay, appreciate the music tonight. Appreciate you coming back to church. This is a good group of folks back on a Sunday night, so I appreciate your faithfulness to the Lord. Anytime we come to church, we do it for the Lord, because this is the Lord's house, and we gather as His body. And so I hope that you're focused tonight to hear something fresh from the Lord. And so I appreciate that. We had a great time at my home this afternoon with some of our newer members to our church. Had a super time. I learned how to use the coffee maker I've owned for 2 years, but I didn't know how to use. So that was a blessing. And just had a good time of fellowship together. And what a great morning we had. Jeff French showed me a picture of our parking lot. You know, I never park on this side of the church. I always come in early and park on the other side, so I never even see the parking lot. I walk across the skywalk. I don't even look out the window. I always look out the kind of the courtyard window, and he showed me a picture of the parking lot this morning, and I'm sorry. I'm sorry if you were looking for a parking place this morning, because I saw one space. In the picture that you took, I saw three people fighting over the one space. But we're trying to be a little bit more sensitive to our needs, our parking needs. We've got the signs up. We're trying to make this top parking lot just dedicated to some of our seniors. We know it's a little bit more of an effort to climb those stairs. We want to be sensitive to that. So we're trying to do a better job up top. Jeff has a team of parking lot workers now on Sunday. If you're looking for a great ministry to get involved in, see Jeff, because we need more help. It's our first impression to guests when they come to our church. So we need people that not just are logistically savvy, but we need people that can smile and be friendly and act like you know where people are supposed to go. Even if you don't know, just with confidence, say it's over there, and there'll be somebody over there that will know. But help us with that if you would. And then one way that you can really help us on Sunday mornings is if you would be willing to park toward the back first. So when you get here, park toward the back. Even better, if you'd be willing to park on the other side of the building. When I mean the other side, you know, where the high school is, Faith Baptist School, the high school wing, the old college building, or you know, the bank parking lot, which is not... obviously, the bank is not open on Sunday, so we can park there. If you'd be willing to park on that side of the building and come in that back door by the back side of the gymnasium, that would actually be a great help. And so if you're looking for just an easy way to be a blessing and a help to others on Sunday, that would be a great way, just to park along the back there, and I know that would be a help to everybody. Hey, would you open your Bible just quickly tonight? And we've got James to come to preach our message tonight, but I wanted to say a word just before he came to preach, and I want you to open your Bible to Deuteronomy chapter 1. Deuteronomy chapter 1. Deuteronomy, as you know, is the fifth book of what we call the Pentateuch. Penta means five, so the first five books of the Bible, sometimes called the law of Moses, the Torah, the Pentateuch. Deuteronomy is the fifth book. Deuteronomy literally means second law. And so it was the law of that God had given to Moses that was being reiterated in sermonic form to the second generation. So there was a generation of people that died in the wilderness, as you know, because they rejected the promise of God, and they were consigned to wander. Those 20 years of age and older died off in the wilderness, and now a second generation was given the opportunity to go into the land of promise. A second generation that many of whom had been alive had seen their fathers make some really bad choices, but now they were going to have their opportunity. And God was giving them some encouragement and some reiteration through these sermons of Moses in the book of Deuteronomy. And so with that in mind, look at Deuteronomy chapter 1 and verse 37. So Moses is recounting the history of that first entrance into the promised land, all that had happened. And Moses told on himself in verse 37. Look at it, verse 37. Also, Moses said, the Lord was angry with me for your sakes, saying, thou also shalt not go in thither. What a blow that must have been for Moses. What a blow that he would not see the promised land, even though initially Moses was the man of faith. Moses was the man that had led the people by faith. Moses was the man that had answered the call by faith. Moses was the one that had to deal with a faithless generation that had rejected the promise of God. And yet, I think most of us know that Moses got to the place where he became frustrated. And when God told him to speak to the rock, remember that? Speak to the rock. That second time, he struck the rock. What a bad symbol that was. Jesus was crucified once. He's that rock, right? And we don't need to strike him again, put him to an open shame. And so the symbol was marred. And God was very, very severe and saying to Moses, Moses, you will not go to the promised land. You will see it. I will show it to you, but you will not go. Paul refers to that in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. We'll get there eventually, because James obviously thinks I go through the Bible at like a snail's pace, but that's for him because he doesn't listen. But we'll get there in 1 Corinthians chapter 10. And Paul referenced that exact thing. He said that, you know, we need to consider these people, this generation, lest we fall. Wherefore, let him that thinketh he standeth take heed lest he fall. That's in the context of understanding how easily people can fall, even people like Moses. So who is Moses? He was a faithful leader who became a fallen leader. The fact that he fell didn't negate his service to God, what he had done all those many years sincerely, but he was a faithful leader who became a fallen leader. And then very soon thereafter became a failing leader. And a man that probably should have and could have lived beyond 120 years did not because of mistakes that he had made. The bottom line is that the best of men are men at best. And I look at our young people at Faith Baptist Church, and you look at us leaders. And I'm going to tell you something. You see people that are people. You see people that are going to make mistakes. You see people that are not going to entirely live up to your expectations. That's just the truth of it. And Moses was, as great as Moses was, you know, Moses had some failings in his life. And yet God said to Moses, I'm not done with my promise, and I'm not done with you, and I'm not done with that next generation. And so watch what God says through Moses in the very next verse. But, and I love that contrast, but Joshua, the son of Nun, which standeth before thee, he shall go in. He shall, Moses, I'm going to have to chastise you. You're not going to see the full measure of my blessings in your life. Okay, but Moses, I'm still going to give you the opportunity to invest in people who can go beyond where you are, who can take the baton from where you are and run to a place to which you cannot run. And it's Joshua who's standing before you. And the idea of standing before somebody meant that Joshua was serving. Joshua wasn't looking for limelight. Joshua wasn't looking to be the heir apparent. He didn't have some kind of a Messiah syndrome about himself. He just served Moses faithfully. And the study of Joshua is an interesting study because when Joshua was in that wilderness, he did whatever was necessary. And sometimes that put Joshua in a very lonely place where he was neither with Moses entirely nor with the people entirely. And many times, training for ministry, following God's call, can be a lonely thing, can be a lonely place. And yet, the Bible says that Joshua, the son of Nun, which standeth before thee, he shall go in thither. Watch this. Encourage him. Encourage him. For he shall cause Israel to inherit it. And I think therein is the responsibility of our local church. Therein is the responsibility of our pastors. Therein is the responsibility of really all of us to that degree. And that is that we have an express responsibility to encourage the next generation to serve God. And I wonder, you know, are we doing that proactively? Are we doing that faithfully? Whereas Moses was a faithful leader, he was a failing leader. Failing in health and vitality, he became a fallen leader. And yet he was given the opportunity by God to invest in a future leader who would not do it the same way, who is gifted in a different capacity to do different things, to go to different places, but an entirely different leadership spectrum about him, and yet he was the man whom God chose. And so this summer, we've put in front of you a number of younger men in our ministry, some in the ministry proper who have a good measure of Bible knowledge and Bible experience, like an Andrew Day who preached last week and did a masterful job, or younger men like Steve Rufner, who preached several weeks ago, did a super job, and like James French tonight. And James, these men are still in Bible college, still young, single men with their whole lives ahead of them, with their whole ministries ahead of them. And we, as a church family, have the opportunity to invest in them. We have the opportunity to say, here's your opportunity to speak to us, to share God's word with us. And so years from now, we can say things like, remember that day? We were there for your first message at church. We were there when you preached that. For remember what you preached about. And that's what I'd like. I'd like for Faith Baptist Church to be a culture, to be a culture where all these men, and I mean they're men, these men that are 20, 21, 22, that these men would go on to serve God. That's my heart. It's like you guys back there in the back row back there. That's what I'm talking about. Like you guys. Like I love you guys. And that my greatest heart for you guys is that you would serve God with your lives. And it just impresses me when young men come to church. It impresses me when young men come on a Sunday night that could be a million different places. That impresses me. And all across this room, we've got young men whom God can touch and use in a great way. And I love that. And I just want you young men to know I'm behind you. Ladies too, for sure. I'm talking about the leadership in local churches. And you guys, you're the leaders. You're the ones up and coming. And our church family, we're behind you. And we want you to know that. You're not perfect, but we're not perfect. You know, here's Jeremiah Gillespie, who grew up at our church in Pennsylvania. I'm going to tell you something. He was not perfect, and he has not arrived. But I thank God for what God's doing in his life. I thank God for what God's doing in James's life. And James French comes from a great family. You know that. The Frenches are among our dearest families here at Faith Baptist Church. And James is going into his senior year of Bible college, praying about all that God has for him in the future. And so I want you to pray for him as well. So James, you're ready to go? I've already listened to his message. We've gone through it already. He just wanted to push the video button, but he's going to have to preach live tonight. And so can we encourage James by welcoming him tonight to preach the message?
All right, in your Bibles, we're going to be in 1 Kings chapter 19. 1 Kings chapter 19. I just want to thank you all so much for coming. It really means a lot. And Pastor Skelly, thank you so much for this opportunity. And the pastoral staff, Pastor McCrum, for hiring me on for the internship. And Pastor Eric and Pastor Josh and Jeremiah for just investing in my life this summer. And it just meant the world to me. Just thank you. I'm actually leaving first thing tomorrow morning for school out in California at West Coast Baptist College. So if you think about it, just pray for me as I go into my senior year, like Pastor said. Thank you so much for coming. 1 Kings chapter 19, as we come, we got to know a couple things before we get into it. There's three things we got to know. First of all, once again, Israel has turned away from God, and because they have, they've turned into idol worship, so God sends Elijah. Number two, because Israel has turned from God, there's been no rain causing a drought for 3 years. And number three, because they've turned away from God, Ahab and Jezebel are ruling in Israel, and they are very wicked. In chapter 18, we see Elijah having a meeting with Ahab. Ahab blames Elijah for causing the drought and famine. Elijah returns with this accusation and says, because of him, Israelites have turned their backs on God, causing the drought. Elijah tells Ahab to gather the 450 prophets of Baal and meet him on Mount Carmel. At the mountain, Elijah challenges the prophets to see which God could produce fire for their sacrifice. What's interesting, Mount Carmel is actually believed to be the dwelling place of Baal. So the prophets of Baal already have the upper hand. So Elijah does, he challenges them. So what they do is build their altar. They have their sacrifice ready. So Elijah says, your God, let's see which God is better. So Elijah has the prophets go. They build their altar. They put their sacrifice on. And the prophets, they begin to pray to their God. And they do this for hours. They do this all day, the Bible says in chapter 18. They're cutting themselves, they're praying, they're throughout the whole day, and nothing's happening. Elijah even teases them and says, maybe your God is on vacation. Maybe your God is sleeping. Maybe that's why there's nothing's happening. This goes on all day. Finally, Elijah says, all right, you've tried, you failed, now it's my turn. So Elijah builds his altar, he gets a sacrifice on there, and to make it even better, he gets his servants and they douse it with water. He douses his altar with water, 3 buckets of water, and it's impossible for fire to start. And we all know the story. Elijah kneels there right next to his altar. He prays a simple but powerful prayer, and immediately fire comes down. Then those prophets, they see what just happened, so they scatter. Elijah gathers for those 450 prophets, and he kills them all. Elijah goes back up the mountain, prays, and it starts raining again. Ahab just saw what just happened, goes down to the city, Jezreel, to tell Jezebel all that just happened. So that's where we are in chapter 19. Elijah prays, fire comes down, he kills all the prophets, it begins to rain, Ahab runs to go tell the queen of everything that just happened. Look at 1 Kings 19, verse number 1. And Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, and with all how he had slain all the prophets with a sword. Then Jezebel sent a message unto Elijah, saying, so let the gods do to me and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. And when he saw that, he arose and went for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongeth to Judah, and left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a juniper tree. And he said, it is enough now, O Lord, take away my life, for I'm not better than my father's. We see in this passage that Elijah has completely given up. He completely exhausted, worn out, discouraged. Nothing seems to be going the way he thought it would. He just had one of the biggest victories probably ever told in the Bible. In his exhaustion, one message, one simple note from Jezebel, Elijah completely forgets everything that God had just did for him. In times of discouragement, it's crucial that we don't forget the victories. And so many times it can happen to us. We can have victory after victory in one trial, one hard time, one pandemic, one situation not going the way we think it ought to. We lay down and we give up. What life problems are distracting you from the will of God? What message has popped up that you've now completely forgotten everything that God had just done for you? And it is crucial that we do not let one difficulty ruin everything God has set up for us. Elijah literally laid down and asked God to kill him. Just one chapter before, he was calling fire down from heaven. This amazing miracle took place, and yet he took his eyes off God and said, "I'm done. Kill me." You can't get any lower than that. He was completely and utterly discouraged. Now, from this passage, I want to look at the ways that God does to help Elijah through his discouragement and how it can apply to us. Look at number one, a caring God. Let's look back at verse number four again. "And he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a juniper tree and requested for himself that he might die and said, 'It is enough now, O Lord, take away my life, for I'm not better than my fathers.'" Look at verse number five. "And as he lay and slept under a juniper tree, behold, an angel touched him and said unto him, 'Arise and eat.'" God sent him help. God cares. It's very easy to forget that simple truth. 1 Peter 5:7 says, "Casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you." God cares about you and can use any situation for his glory. It's through difficult situations where the comfort of the Lord can be felt the most. And it sounds so easy. Just trust God. Anyone can say that, but what if the discouragement is legit? What if the discouragement is real? What if the hurt is bad? Through it, God is still good. The devil is going to do everything he can to make you want to quit. Discouragement often comes when life is not as easy as we thought it would. We completely give up, not only on ourselves, but on God. We think, because it didn't go according to our plan, how could a God that loves let this event happen? It is in these times where our faith in God is truly tested and shows who your faith really is. Are you trusting God with your life in the easy and the difficult times? Are you trusting in God in the easy and the difficult times? Let's make a commitment to trust in God in any season of life. Let's make a commitment today. If you get anything from this message, let's make a commitment today to trust in God in every area of life. When times got rough, Elijah forgot about the victory God gave him. We see Elijah being comforted by the Lord in his time of uncertainty. We see a God who never turns his back on us. Even though Elijah turned his back on God, God did not turn his back on Elijah. Whatever hurt you're going through, God will be right there with you. In discouragement, let's be in the Word of God. When we are discouraged, we need to stop and listen for God's voice, not others around us, not through media, not through worldly advice, but through the Word of God and His Spirit. It's through the comfort of the Lord we can get through a discouraging situation. When trial comes, we need to remember to serve. We serve. When something happens that discourages us, we need to remember, first of all, we serve a God that cares. Number two, we see an all-knowing God. Look at the provision of the Lord. Look at verse number six. "And he looked, and behold, there was a cake baking on the coals and a curse of water at his head. He did eat and drink and laid him down again." God knew exactly what Elijah needed. He was absolutely exhausted. And sometimes when a discouragement comes, we need to just rest and remember what God has already provided for us. And God had already provided for Elijah multiple times before this. In 1 Kings chapter 17, we see the story of Elijah and Ahab. It was at the beginning of the drought, and Ahab is threatening Elijah again. So what God does is move Elijah down to the brook Cherith to comfort him and to protect him. God protected Elijah multiple times. He gave him food. He gave him water there at the brook Cherith. He gave exactly what Elijah needed. And God provides for us again and again. It says every good and perfect gift comes from above. Are you trusting in him? Many times we need to just rest in the provision that God has already given us. Trials and difficulties are also a time for God to provide and show himself to us. Trials give God an opportunity to show us how much we need him. God knew exactly what Elijah needed in his time of trouble. Elijah needed a rest. Many times that's all we need to do. We just need a rest in the Lord. Philippians 4:19 says, "But my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus." Paul tells the Philippians while in prison that God's got you. Rejoice in the Lord, he says in Philippians 4. God desires for you to rest in him in discouraging times. God gave Elijah exactly what he needed in his times of discouragement. Not only do we see a comforting God, not only do we see an all-knowing God, but we see number three, a strengthening God. Look back in verse number seven. And the angel of the Lord came again the second time and touched him and said, arise and eat, because the journey is too great for thee. And he arose and did eat and drink and went in the strength of the meat 40 days and 40 nights unto Horeb, the mount of God. We see the persistence of the Lord. The Lord came again and again to help Elijah get the rest and encouragement he needed. The author of Hebrews quotes Jesus saying, I will never leave thee nor forsake you. Have you given up on God? Have you lost your faith in him when discouragement comes? Elijah did. He was ready to die, but the mercy and grace of God was with him. In times of discouragement, we must remember what God will do, and will never turn his back on us. He knows your needs. He knows what you need. He will give you the strength to go on. You are never alone in times of discouragement. The angel came a second time. God was persistent in giving Elijah the rest and provision he needed. God didn't take the trial away. Did you notice that? God didn't just zap Jezebel out of the picture. He didn't take the messenger out to take the note away. He didn't take the trial away. But God was right there with him. But God gave him what he needed through this situation. The devil in your time of discouragement will make you feel completely alone. However, Jesus is always with you. One of the lies of the devil is that Jesus doesn't care about you anymore. Jesus was without sin, and yet he died on the cross for you. Jesus is with you through it all. A God who would give his own life would not give up on you. You are valuable to him. Amen. Are you relying on him? Amen. Are you trusting in him? In times of trouble or not, Jesus is all you need. And when I was younger, I was in middle school and high school, I was a competitive swimmer. And in swimming, not only are you against other people in the pool, but you're also up against the clock. You're up against the clock. It's always ticking. Every second counts in that race. If you make one mistake, one stroke too short, it could cost you the race. I've had many times in laps where I've missed the wall. I've come up too close. I've had good days and bad days. And a good coach would tell you what you did wrong and what you need to work on to get through the race and to overcome the next bad day. In life, we all know there's good days and bad days. There are many times where we'll miss the mark, we'll come up too short, we'll miss the wall, but our God is willing and able to forgive us and help us through the trial that he set before us. Let's learn from Elijah's mistake. We have, number one, a God who cares. We have, number two, an all-knowing God. God knows exactly what you're going through and what you need. And number three, we see a strengthening God. God will give you the rest you need in times of discouragement. So is there a situation that you're going through that's distracting you or hurting you from the will of God? God will never leave you in times of trouble. He's always there when you need him. Elijah needed to lean and trust in God in his time of discouragement. Have you completely put your faith in him through any situation, good and the bad? It is critical in times of discouragement that you do not forget the victories. Let's make a decision today to put our full confidence and faith in God. Let's not forget the victories. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for this day. God, thank you for the example you've given to us through Elijah, that we can learn from his mistake. God, I pray that each one of us will make that decision. In the good times and the bad, Lord, we'll trust in you. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
So let's keep our heads bowed and our eyes closed for just a moment, just to give some thought to the message. Maybe you're at a lonely, discouraging place in your life right now. And this message was exactly what God had prescribed for you, to be reminded that he is the God that cares. He is the God that knows. He is the God that strengthens. And he's not going to take the trial away necessarily. But maybe that trial was there for you to realize that God was equal to and greater than any trial you could possibly face. What a message. In just a moment, I'm going to ask us to do something, and James is going to play. I want us in just a moment to break into groups of two or four people. Just the people around you. If you want to pray as a couple, that's fine. But I'd like for us to pray for our young people tonight. I want us to pray for the next generation. If you are a young person, I want you to just pray for yourself that you would honor God, serve God with your life. If you're not a young person, I want you to pray that God would bless these college students. Bless our school year. Bless our high school kids. Keep them safe and pure, holy and honest. Let's pray for them. I pray for James as he completes his senior year at Bible College. Pray that God would raise up servants out of our church to go to foreign mission fields. Pray that God would tenderize our hearts for an upcoming missions conference. We'd be sensitive to the call of God upon our own lives. Just to pray. And so in just a moment, I'm going to begin praying, and then James, I'm going to have you just play an appropriate song, and let's just divide up. Not to talk, just go right to prayer. Elect somebody in the group to pray for the group, and let's pray for the young people of Faith Baptist Church. Father, I pray that this would be a sweet time. Pray, Lord, as we go to prayer, that you would help us to earnestly and sincerely lift up the names of young people in this very room, in this very church. I pray that, Lord, of all that you have given us, and you've given us a slew of young people, the babies in the nursery, just beginning, children by the dozens roaming the halls and making friends, and teenagers and young people that are just trying to figure out life. Lord, I pray that of all that you have given us, we would not even lose one of them to this world and to the devil. I pray, God, that each one of them would discover you all by himself. I pray that each one of them would have a full and sincere and vibrant faith. I pray, God, that you would protect them, help them, guide them, direct them, empower them, save them, secure them for your purposes. Please, Lord, bless the young people of our church, I pray. The music is playing. Let's divide up into just a group or two. Pray for just a couple minutes tonight together. Father, we do lift up each one of our young people at Faith Baptist Church to you. Oh God, I pray that you would give them a sense of your presence in their lives. Oh God, I pray that you would keep their eyes focused entirely upon you. Oh God, I pray that you would show them the utter fallacy of following a world system. Eat them up and chew them up and spit them out. Oh God, I pray that you'd help them to see the only one life that matters. Help them, God, to remember their Creator in the days of their youth. Oh God, I pray that you'd help them to establish godly habits today. Oh, follow them for a lifetime. Oh God, I pray you deliver them from the pressure of peers and trinkets of this world. I pray, God, that you'd give them a seriousness about serving you. I pray, God, that you'd give us a school year that would be a revival atmosphere. I pray that you'd work in our youth. Pray, God, that you'd bless our families. Wake up a mom or dad, perhaps. Help us to have a sense of urgency about a country that is just rapidly decaying. Oh God, tonight, we give you and pray for our young people. Bless them. Bless those that are traveling this week to school. Give them a great semester. Help us to be praying as we ought at home. And now bless us as we go our separate ways. Bless the refreshment that we will receive. Bless our time of fellowship. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.